I met Lawrence Tierney in the early 90s, and now we can say early 90s, through a friend named Ron Zwang, who's a screenwriter, introduced me to Larry, said, you got to meet this guy, Lawrence Tierney. I was just struck by his look. He's sort of one part chiseled, good-looking actor meets Tor Johnson. There's something about Larry's face that every crevice, every wrinkle tells 100 tales. You can look in that face and you can see bar fights and dysfunctional relationships with women and, you know, every hardship that he endured, you know, from alcohol to everything. It's all in that face. I mean, they don't make faces like that anymore. When Lawrence Tierney died, I mean, a whole generation of tough guys just went away.
I loved Lawrence. I just really loved him. He was wonderful. But he was completely a directorial, you know, school by fire. Even like Harvey Keitel, you know, Quentin, I've made a lot of movies and I've never dealt with a crazy motherfucker like Lawrence Tierney.
He was a very, very funny guy, and he was really kind of like a big teddy bear. You know, he was kind of like a big mentor to all of us. And as annoying as it was to work with him and to play a scene with the man, it's just so incredibly aggravating.
My Tim wouldn't even act with him in the same room. I don't want that fat fuck in the goddamn room when I'm acting.
And at one point, I think Harvey and Steve had to pry them, Quentin and Lawrence, apart. I mean, seriously. You're trying to ruin my film.
Fuck you. It's usually even funnier when, like, you get a Steve Buscemi or you get a Michael Madsen telling the story.
I remember that Lawrence Tierney got in a big argument with Quentin that day and got fired.
I'll let the other guys tell that story. I'm not sure what they're going to say. That was a funny one.
It was the last 20 minutes of the last day of shooting of the first week. He didn't like my dialogue. He had a hard time remembering it. And it was, yeah, it's fucking shit, you're too fucking convoluted.
Somebody comes up with the phone, comes up with the phone, finally, so fucking I fuck up. I'll keep going. Stop.
I'm just saying, it's so fucking repetitive. I'm just saying the same thing over again. What do you mean?
You don't say anything about you, anything but you, I'm up. It's because it's so fucking repetitive.
No, hey, I don't want to say that joke you give me, that fucking dirty joke, it's disgusting.
Oh, you guys like to tell jokes and giggle and kid around, huh? Giggling like a bunch of young bros in a schoolyard. Well, let me tell a joke. It was no good. Fuck it.
Yeah, we'll do it one more time. He also had this thing where you'd be trying to talk to him. Okay, so Lawrence, and then all of a sudden he would just start walking away. All right, right in the middle of your talking. All right, not like, fuck you. You know, he just... start going, like you're supposed to be trailing after him. And so Lawrence, And again, last 20 minutes, very important part of the story. And I grab him by the arm and I go, Lawrence, stay here! And he shoves me. And he's just like, get your fucking hands off me! Alright? I'm like, this fucker gonna touch me in my set? Fuck him.
I think Quentin was going to do him physical harm. I remember him lunging at Lawrence.
Get your fucking hands on me, kid! Fuck you, you fat fuck! You're fucking fired! Take your fat fucking ass off my fucking set!
I think I was holding Lawrence and Harvey was holding Quentin. It might have been vice versa. I don't remember, but I know that there was an effort made to keep them away from each other. Someone definitely would have got hurt.
Storm off the set this way. Lawrence, boom! Storms off the set that way.
And I remember he left the set and he was walking down the middle of the street with cars coming by and everything.
The crew breaks out into applause. They brought us together, and then it's like we see each other and we both kind of calm down a little bit now. It's like 20 minutes later. I'm sorry. Oh no, kid, I'm sorry. You know, and it was just really nice and everything. And then he did it again. It was just schizophrenic nature. Now he was really sweet. Then he was just like, so kid, how about this? You know, we're all going to go out. You know, me and the whole crew, we're all going to go out and drink and have a good time. He goes, all right, kid, how about you? Me and you, we're going to go out and we're going to drink. We'll put this all behind us, you know? And I go, no, yeah, I didn't really feel like going out and drinking with Lawrence Tierney.
he wasn't supposed to drink, and we were all encouraged not to let him drink. So naturally, the first thing we did was take him out for drinks. I brought him to Musso and Frank's one time, and we were sitting at the bar, and we had many, many vodka tonics, and suddenly he says, I'm leaving. I got to go to the bathroom. And so he wandered off, and didn't come back for quite some time, and we all wondered, what happened to Lawrence? You know, where in the hell is he? I heard a lot of automobiles out in front of the restaurant. They were all honking and all that. And a lot of commotion, you know. So I went and I looked out the windows, and there's Lawrence standing in the middle of the street with his drawers down and going like this. And there's cars just screeching to a halt and going around him and driving around him, and he was yelling at everyone and pointing at them. It was very strange.
He'd drop his pants in the parking lot and stuff, and introduce me, take me to bars and introduce me to the man who invented the yo-yo that lights up. Those were his mates. You go, okay.
I heard that he physically went through a wall at some friends of mine's house one night. Like the Incredible Hulk, he apparently just went through a kitchen wall into a dining room. I would love to have seen that.
He would call up, be in a bar, get drunk, call up the cops, say, there's a fight down here, everyone's going crazy. The cops would turn up and he'd beat up the cops.
If he was here right now, he would physically attack me. And I, you know, I annoyed him for some reason. I think everyone annoyed him, but me in particular, he did come after me once.
Sitting in the rehearsal room, and Lawrence Tierney was there. And Lawrence has scars all over his head, you know. He has a big head. And I remember sitting there looking at Eddie, and Eddie was looking at Lawrence like that. I said, what's with you and Lawrence? He said, I was just sitting there trying to work out if I'd put those scars there or not. I'm like, what? And there's a couple of stories there that go way back about that.
You know the guy that was in Reservoir Dogs, the old guy that just died?
Lawrence Tierney.
Lawrence Tierney. I had a fight with him in the parking lot back there behind this place in the 50s. You know? What happened, I'd get in a fight with him. I pulled up in the parking lot with a broad, and Lawrence Tierney was beating the shit out of his brother. He had him up against the wall and was slamming him in the wall, and the chick was with me said, hey, Eddie, hey, baby. What would you do to that guy? I said, man, I'd look like Sugar Ray Robinson on his ass, you know? So I swing on him, I punch on him, and I miss. I don't hit him right. My arm kind of goes around him. If you've ever been in fights, you punch and you miss, and I don't get him with a full on the chin. I don't hit him right, you know? And he's a big guy. So in a couple of minutes, he's got my coat over my head, man. I'm really busting my mouth open. This is in the 50s.
This is way before Reservoir Dogs. You guys had a history.
Uh-huh.
Did he remember you?
No.
The rumor has it that the cops actually took him to the state line and threw him across it. Well, he was such trouble. He's such trouble.
Before we started rehearsing, we had an informal barbecue at a place Harvey was leasing on the beach. Well, I had just seen a movie called The Devil Thumbs a Ride with this guy. It was Lawrence Tierney in the end. But I didn't know it was Lawrence Tierney. This was like 3 weeks before. I said, I wonder what happened to this prick. I go, this guy is so mean. He probably never worked again, but he's a good-looking guy. He can act, but he's just not one redeeming quality about the character, and he didn't care.
Have you ever seen the movie Devil Thumbs a Ride? That could be called the Lawrence Tierney story, all right? Because it's all about like some nice guy who's driving down the street, and Lawrence Tierney's hitchhiking on the side of the road, and you stop to pick him up. You're having a good day, and you're a nice guy, but because you bumped into Lawrence Tierney, he's going to ruin your life. All right, from that moment on, your day is going to be fucked and your life is going to be ruined while he's in your presence.
I end up inviting him to a barbecue at my house. And he says, okay, great, great. So I said, well, you know, we'll have a barbecue before we start shooting. It was like 2 weeks before we had to start shooting. I said, we'll have a barbecue and, you know, get to know each other a little bit and be great. He goes, great. That's fine. I leave. Next morning, 8 a.m., I get a phone call. Hello? I'm just getting up. He goes, yeah, it's Lawrence. What time should I be there? I go, no. I mean, before we start shooting, we'll get together. I mean, I got some things. No, what time? Come on, I got today. What time should I be there? The guy's like, you know, just already bullying me, right?
You never want to invite Lawrence over to your house because basically you're going to have a guest for like the next like 2 weeks until you actually have to forcibly call a cop.
So I go, okay, be here about noon. Well, where am I coming? So I give him the address of Malibu. He goes, is that, okay, well, I got to take the bus 5, the bus 96, to the bus 77, to the 367, and then I'll catch on the, it's like 16 buses he's got to take to get there. I don't know where he's coming from. So I'll be there at about 12:16. Pick me up at the bus station. And he's there with his Bermuda shorts on, you know, a Hawaiian shirt, all his toiletries, like some underwear and a shirt. You know, he's like, he's planning on staying a while. So it's, he gets to the house. This is a true story. And I got a Cracker Barrel cheese and bread, and I'm cooking monster steaks. The guy eats all the bread. He eats the whole thing. He goes, you got any more of that cheese? I go, Lawrence, there's going to be a huge steak on your way, big salad, vegetables, the whole thing. Just wait a minute. He goes, he gets a big quart of juice, drinks the whole thing. Guy's amazing. People tell stories like this about me, so I can tell the story. People said this about me for years. I finally got a guy I could tell it about. So then he goes, hey, he goes, you got a nice place here. I said, well, it's not really mine. It's my folks' place. Yeah, but it's nice by the ocean. But you need some lawn furniture. And there's lawn furniture everywhere in the yard, everywhere. I go, Lawrence, look at this beautiful, you know, lawn furniture. It's all over. He says, yeah, but you need, you could use some more. You could use some more. You might have a party. I got some for you. I'm going to give it to you when we get to my house. And when we get to your house, he says, oh, yeah, the buses don't run late enough. Meanwhile, his nephew calls me up. He goes, hey, is my uncle there? I go, yeah, he's here. He says, don't let him use the phone. He'll call Alaska for 3 hours. He said, just keep an eye on him. He's a good-hearted guy. And he is a good-hearted guy. So the day progresses. The steaks are finished. You know, I've definitely told him there's no way I want the lawn furniture. So we eat the steaks, have a great time. And we end up, it's like it's about time for him to go home. Next thing I see, he's in my bed asleep. Just out. Had a nice steak, you know, a couple of quarts of juice. He's out cold. Wake up about 3 hours later, and he's like a soldier ready to go to war. He goes, all right, where are we going? What are we doing? I said, well, we're going home. I'm taking you home. He goes, what? What, already? He goes, come on, it's 6 o'clock. Come on, let's go out. Let's have fun. He wanted to go out and, you know, hang out. I go, I really got to go. I got stuff I got to do, Lawrence. I really do. But, you know, the next few days, we will. He goes, all right, fine. Be a Scrooge, you know, be a fucking crumb or whatever. So we get in the car, we're heading out. He goes, let's at least get some dessert. We have tiramisu. And when he's done eating the tiramisu, he takes the pewter vase from the center of the table. He goes, I'm going to wait for you out in the truck. He goes out to the truck. My buddy's with me. He goes, you know, you just took the vase off the table. I go, hey, let him have the vase. These guys are friends. So I tell the guys, they go, no, don't worry about it. It's all right. So we're heading over to his apartment on Hollywood Boulevard. And he looks at me, he goes, he says, well, at least come to my house. He says, because I've got some videotapes of some movies I did, and I want you to see them. So I go, great. I mean, that's what I want. I go, and by the way, you know, what's with the vase? He said, I didn't take a vase. I said, who said you took one? I said, what's with one? He said, I didn't take none. He says, come on, I want to give you them tapes. So we go to his house. He's got this apartment on Hollywood Boulevard. Goes up, he goes, hey, hang on a minute. So I'm going to bring you them tapes down here. So I'm waiting in the car at Hollywood Boulevard, and Lawrence Tierney comes down the elevator. Looks at me with a shopping basket full of lawn furniture and goes, and here's that lawn furniture I told you about. Here's the tapes. I go, Lawrence, I told you I didn't want it. And he goes, well, what the fuck did you make me bring it down here for? And then he walked away. So, that's Lawrence Tierney. In a nutshell.